All right, welcome back to the Kinguin Pro League Season 1 Grand Finals. We're about to basically seal the league, so...
That's the last match.
It's the last match of the entire league. Kolento versus the Lifecoach, like the culmination of 2 months and a half of casting. What I'm really considering is like how long it's taken to get there. Like how much work has been put.
It has been 9 weeks of gameplay.
Yeah.
We had two groups of 10 players each. Each of the player had to play against each other player from his group. And then the best players from the first three spots advanced to the playoffs. So the first place was seeded into the semifinal.
Right.
Second and third place was seeded into the quarterfinals. And now those players are playing in the playoffs. So that took us 2.5 months. And it was really exciting to cast those matches. It was a new experience to me too. It's it's the first league.
It's the first Hearthstone league that we've had that was ongoing and that took so long to really culminate into a finals. Usually you had a lot of best of fives, best of sevens, double elimination. But a league like this, where every week the players come back with a new meta game, adapted deck lists, that's pretty novel, I say, for
and
Hearthstone.
It's also will be something innovative in the future, season, because five players from each group that didn't get good, I should say, in this season, they are demoted from the league, so they are being kicked out, you can say that, from this season, and new players will have the opportunity to be a part of the next season. So we'll have two, I don't know if exactly two, but few qualifiers that will be opening 10 spots in general for season 2, so that's the opportunity for new players to make their names out here.
Yeah, because if you start with 20 players, initially the idea was that we'd get 3 players out of each group out, but then the ruling was changed to where 5 players of each group would get knocked. So for season 2,
so more flesh
half blocks. Yeah, exactly, like half of the people in the season will be new. You may not know them. I'm sure a lot of the names we'll recognize because a lot of the pro players who may not get reinvited will probably qualify again for the open qualifiers since they're so consistent. It's nothing to be surprised about. But that still opens up a lot of opportunities for people who don't really have a foot in the scene to become more known in season 2. So Kolento and Lifecoach, they were both in the same group, in Group Horde, before the playoffs. So they had to. They were basically both in the same top 3. So they faced each other before during the league.
Mm-hmm.
Lifecoach won that match, if I recall, versus Kolento fairly convincingly.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Lifecoach was on a hot streak during all the league, and this is a chance to prove that he's still on it. If he gets this win, this will probably be the hottest streak in tournament play in general since the beginning of the league, I'd say.
I say so, right? Well, he had a 5-0 start, right? Or 4-1? No, 4-0 start.
4-0, then 4-1.
4-1, yeah. It started to be rocky after the first 4 wins, but still.
Yeah, first 4 wins, in the league where you're going to play 9 matches, I'd say that's a pretty good time to start getting.
Yeah, I guess so, yeah. So, looking forward to this match. I think this is like the pinnacle of the whole tournament, and we have the two best players, and not only two best players in this tournament, but I feel like those are the best two players that we have in the league. At least that would be my shot.
It's pretty insane because if you think about it, the entire league was stacked with the really just amazing players.
Mm-hmm.
But out of them, a lot of people have proven their consistency.
Yeah.
And I would say we all found them in the playoffs.
Yeah, that's
which
true.
Is incredible when you think about the supposed amount of variance that we should be encountering in a game like Hearthstone. There is variance. But the people who play better in general are more consistent and seem to always make it to the later stages
That's
of their tournaments.
If you would ask me who would I bet my money on in this league, I would say Kolento Lifecoach. That's
probably
the final. That's the final I wanted to see, and that's the final I would have guessed.
I was almost hoping Firebat. Like, I was betting on Firebat coming into this today, but it just didn't work for him. Like, nothing seemed to go right for some weird reason. The rogue play that he had was just so weird. Sadly, I won't get to see him in the finals, but Kolento and Lifecoach is a good, you know, consolation prize. It's just, it's actually just an amazing game.
I would
that we're
say
gonna
it will be super exciting.
So it might take quite a while since both players take a lot of time to, you know, to play their match. Before we move on to the grand finals, though, I'd like to show you a video, if you've not seen it earlier, which maybe you haven't if you tuned in during the stream, a video, a tribute to all the participants who were in the league during the season, as well as the little presentation for you. So we'll be right back with the finals match. All right, welcome back for the very grand finals of the Kinguin Pro League Season 1. We're about to begin the very, very last match of the entire season.
Best of seven.
Yeah, it's a best of seven conquest format. Each player has four decks. They've already played those decks earlier today against other opponents. They haven't been allowed to swap decks as a result of maybe able to glean information and adapt too easily to other opponents. So as a result, they'll have the same decks. But I didn't expect Kolento with his lineup. I mean, he's the only player who's brought Priest.
You're saying that you didn't anticipate the Priest?
Not at all. I didn't anticipate the Priest to win as much as it did during the league, the entire league. The Priest from Kolento has been a great surprise because every single time you think it's going to have a problem with specific matchups, and somehow it wins.
Yeah, so like against Rogue, right?
Rogue, Druid, every time I saw those two matchups, I think to myself, the game is over with the Priest, but then Kolento wins. And I just keep getting... I don't even understand what's going on. Yeah, I'm surprised by it, but at the same time, I'm starting to wonder if something's wrong with my assessment of Priest, because everybody seems to agree that it's...
Maybe that's why we were sitting here and they're
not
playing.
Not there, yeah. But like nobody else plays it. So I'm still not sure what's going on. So Kolento just playing amazingly well as Priest deck.
He has to prove something also now, because the first match, first game, will be Priest versus Warlock.
Yeah, that's a really tough match. Like, let me just not say that it's unwinnable, because that's not a good thing. But it's going to be really tough.
It's really tough. It's really tough for the Priest player because even if you play double Shadow of Death, I've said that it's not enough to deal with the pressure that Handler brings. Well, I'm not sure if Life Coach plays Jaraxxus anymore in his deck because that's the...
It's a flex spot for him. I've seen him take out Jaraxxus and put in other cards instead. It's not something that he always plays. So he has a few variants, some of which include demons, no giants, or the other way around, where he has giants and no demons at all.
Yeah. Well, we'll have to see how it goes. Like, the Jaraxxus, usually you just slam it on board in turn 9 against a Priest.
And you win, yeah.
There's almost no way of Priest dealing with that. You have a 6/6 creature every single turn. how do you deal with that?
Like, the only variants that did really well were the Light Bomb ones. You know, Deathlord, Valence Chosen, and Light Bomb. But then again, they have sometimes a weaker matchup against other things. And it still comes down to the Warlock letting you draw. If you don't draw off of Northshire, if you never get a good Northshire cleric turn, usually you can't stay in the race. Because they end up tapping, and you can't punish them.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true.
All right.
So we'll be jumping into the game.
First
Grand
game.
Finals.
Grand
game
Finals,
one.
Yeah. Priest
Kolento
versus Warlock.
In the red corner. Lifecoach in the red corner.
the Horde has been dominating this entire race, and I absolutely am underrepresented, but it's okay. You know, you should have dressed in red, now that I think of it.
Maybe I should.
You should have.
But red shirt on camera looks awful.
Oh, man. Red shirt guy.
I would die instantly.
And the Northshire cleric here for Kolento. Like, Lifecoach has to have the answer. This is the only way a priest wins in this matchup, is when he does get a good amount of card draw.
I guess so, but still, it's not easy to do.
No, but it's the only way I've ever seen somebody win. It's not amazing, mind you, but...
No kind of lack turn three. You want to keep the coin, or just play the Alchemy?
Light of the Naru face, heal face.
I guess you crane out the Alcanai.
Yeah, might as well. Kolento does that a lot. It's a very good pressure play. A very strong pressure play. Which is, I think, a mistake a lot of people make, to just keep it for when they get the combo. You can be played as a 3-5 or 4.
Yeah. Well. Because there's some issues with the spectator mode, but we see... Now the other hand. So we get. I guess we know that there's a giant 10-4.
I'm pretty sure that's going to be slammed on the board. And Kolento didn't have a Shadow Ward Death.
No, he didn't.
So, really big issue there. Handling this is going to come down to Alcanai doing a lot of work.
Alcanai? Well, even though it will be Alcanai next turn, that's not enough damage. Well, there's Light of Naru.
Yeah, Light of the Naru is going to be 3 plus...
Wow.
I told you. Light of the Naru, heal face.
Okay. I was actually thinking you're joking.
You thought I was trolling.
Yeah.
I don't blame you. I don't blame you. No, no, it's actually a legit play against Handlock.
Okay.
Lothar was like, wait, what?
Life Coach is also like this. Like, wait, what?
No, I do like it.
To be honest, I would really love to see the autoplay, which is...
Alcanai with Light.
Alcanai.
Yeah.
With coin. And then next turn you have Light of Naru to deal 3 damage. So you deal 5 with your hero power, so you can trade the Alcanai into the giant.
Into the giant, yeah. And just finish it off. And you still get the 1-2.
Yeah. Because now you have no option to heal, right? Your hero is at full.
Yeah, it comes down to perfect wild pyro, but... It's just going to be heal face, punch face. That's what I like about Light Warden. He could attack into the giant and set up a better Alcanai later.
I guess so. Now we have double handlock hand.
Yeah. We're back to 25 health.
Back to 25.
Back to 25 after all has been done.
I guess a proper play here is maybe... Fire?
Yeah, the only drawback with that is you're putting your guy into Alcanai's circle range.
Yeah, you do. That's true.
That's the only issue with that play. But...
So what about Ancient
Watcher, Sun Fury, and kill the 1-5?
Yeah.
Or go face? Well, I go 1-5, but pick your...
I think you... Like, you don't want to miss 8 damage.
Can you... Does it matter against Priest?
I think it matters.
Okay.
Like, you put him on the clock with that kind of play.
All right.
I guess the spectator kind of bugs. So we'll have to wait for...
Mountain Giant to move.
Yeah, there's a huge Mountain Giant, man.
It does kill the Northshire Cleric. And he's gonna go for the Watcher Taunt. Probably just the Watcher alone.
Watcher... Taunt,
yeah. As expected. And we see a Hearthstone cursor in the middle. Am I hallucinating this?
No, you're seeing that right.
Okay.
I see it too.
Well, there's a big watcher on the screen.
Oh, thank you. It's like an annoying fly, you know?
Yeah.
It's like sit there and it does nothing and you're like, what the hell?
What's wrong with you, fly? Right, now, Kolento. Not loving the ancient watcher.
Well, at least he can trade one for one. But there's the looming mountain giant.
Yeah. He needs to have Shadow or Death. Like, we don't know what he drew in the meantime, but maybe he does have the death now.
Remember the times where mountain giants were 12-12?
I remember the time where... What was it? The Drakes were +1/+1. All right, so we're being told that the hand for Kolento will be unseeable for the time being, because every mode is glitching. So for the time being, we'll just be casting from Mike Horsch's perspective.
Too bad.
Sorry, yeah, too bad. A little unfortunate. Oh, Shrinkmeister.
Is it
Shadow Word Pain?
That turn? Wait, what?
No. What the hell? Shadow Madness. Well played. But
can
he can't
heal?
Attack.
That kind of... Yeah, that's... that.
It can't attack, mate.
Okay, so I guess there will be Holy Nova next turn.
Oh, wow. It's Kolento. What? What just happened?
I think that he has Holy Nova in his hand, if
I remember
correctly.
Bro, it has to be that. And Life Coach is just like, okay, something happened, but I'm not sure what.
And now, Life Coach can go with Defender of Argus to be out of range of Holy Nova.
But there's Arcanine Circle at least, so that will take care of everything.
That's that, but still.
Yeah, no, from our perspective, it almost looks as though Kolento thought he could attack with the Watcher and trade into the Giant.
Well, Lifecoach has to know that this telegraphs a Holy Nova, right?
Yeah, I think it does. But it's still going to be fine for Kolento. He's very happy with what's about to happen here. Yeah. It's the perfect board clear. It
but then
into
it's
coil,
Mortal
but,
Coil yeah. into Arcanine.
But still, it's a pretty good board wipe.
It is. That's true.
It's pretty hard already to get board wipes against.
I don't think Life Coach is really mad about that. It's like,
no.
That's ought to happen at some point of the game.
And his hand is way too big for this to matter very much.
Yeah. So Mortal Coil first, I would say.
Yeah.
Maybe
start
we will
with
get
that.
A second giant.
No, that would be a sick draw.
Oh, look at that!
Wow.
Look at that! Who appeared?
A skill stone.
I guess you drop it, right? There was no answer to the
first
one.
Yeah, the first one took forever to be answered, and he will curve into Ragnaros.
The Ragnaros next turn will be just disastrous. By the way, I really love the sound of the giants, of the mountain giants, and fell reavers. It's like the most sound.
Yeah, you can tell they're 8/8s. Now, by the way, I'd like to point out the mountain giant just got mounted. But Ragnaros is...
Mounted?
Probably not. But let's say it did.
Well, now Ragnaros should have a free kind of way to appear on the board.
I don't think there's going to be an answer from Kolento right now, unless Sylvanas comes out. Which we've seen him play earlier. So like it's pretty standard in every priest deck.
Yeah. And there's no Owl for that. But you can play like a... Healbot? No, we don't want to play Healbot.
Oh. Wow, if this is his turn, this is not
really
good.
Weak. What about... No, you're one of 50-50 lethal with
Hellfire
Dark Bomb, yeah.
Ah, we found the hand from Kolento. It was hidden under the Kinguin image. I can't believe no one pulled
clever.
That up.
Very
it's
clever.
Been there all along, man.
Very
right?
clever.
Yeah, I knew everybody could pull it up. Yeah, Kolento's hand is devastatingly bad right now.
I think there's no way he can pull it off. So what about Sylvanas? It's one turn away from mind control, if you're worrying about that.
I think you can play it very, very slowly.
Why not tap first?
Yeah, I'm curious.
No, that's 10, never mind.
That would have been 10 cards, right?
Yeah. No, 11, I mean.
Yeah, he would have overdrawn with the tab.
Yeah.
Well, when you see a Warlock Dark Bomb face on a priest,
smoking,
there's something happening here.
Dr. Boom, that's quite something if there would be no AoE.
Yeah.
In Lifecoach's hand.
Unfortunately, that's not the case.
Well, it can still kill the Ragnaros.
Yeah, of course. Well, actually, let me just not say no, because I've seen all sorts of things.
Look at that. If only the Hellfire would have cost 3. Emperor, why you do that? Imagine, 10-10.
Well, we saw that earlier with like BGH, Dr. Boom, what the other card was. I forget what it was. Drake. 2. It was just the craziest play. Emperor is, like, in slow matchups, it's just so obscene in Handlock.
Wait, the far left, it's Hellfire, not Shadow Flame, right?
Yeah, it's Hellfire. I mean, you could kill him with a 50-50 unless Rag dies. You attack face with Belcher, you Hellfire, and you had a 50-50.
I think you go for it.
Yeah.
You can play also...
anything you want first, like, it's... Oh, actually, that's a good idea.
Yeah, that's a very good idea.
That's the best idea.
That's the best idea ever, because now we can steal the 7-7.
Yeah, and now lose.
Probably get a 100% lethal.
Well,
that's
100%.
That's a 100% lethal. 8 damage to the face, firebolt.
Lifecoach takes the first game. Kolento's priest was not fit for this. I mean, it was pretty obvious. We are going into it. We knew it was a bad matchup, but this just showed that even Kolento, unless like the dream happens, can't really beat the Handlock very easily. With priest, it's very difficult.
Yeah, it is. It is. It's almost unbeatable, I would say.
Yeah, it's one of those matchups where I guess the Light Bomb version has a much better matchup in general. Mm-hmm. The win rate is much higher because Light Bomb takes care of the giants right away. Just like it can kill 2 giants at once, finish off some minions on the board,
like, and typically. Direction.
As a priest, like Misdirection, yeah, exactly. The old Misdirection, that's Light Bomb now. They renamed it. And there's one thing I wish I'd seen more of with priest since BRM is that Resurrect.
Yeah.
I haven't seen any competitive deck play with Resurrect yet.
I feel it just doesn't fit the current priest that is being played. Like, there's no incentive of resurrecting random minion because most of those minions have to be played from your hand to achieve some kind of combination.
So you have to play them as a combo. And you can't say, oh, I'd like to get a Wild Pyro now. Yeah. And
I would like to get a Cabal Shadow Priest from the graveyard. I was like, you.
Yeah, you're right. A lot of demons don't do anything.
Yeah.
Maybe when priests get... I think what priest needs right now is a 2-drop. Like a really good 2-drop to fill the
turf. Yeah, Shrinkmeister, what are they talking about?
It's not. It's.
Yeah, like, I know.
It's like... Like Shadow Boxer is almost better than Shrinkmeister for that.
It's actually a good card.
I know. It's the thing. It's like it's good, but it doesn't. It's not good enough, right? It's like it's a bit missing from it to make it pass the test for priests at this point, which is a bit unfortunate. I mean, the priests are relegated to being a very reactive class. As a result,
true.
They're always very, very reactive.
But maybe the game. The metagame changes so fast that I'll be not surprised if, like, in next few weeks, maybe with the next expansion latest, we'll see priests being on the top of the food chain.
Right.
Because I still remember the time when Hunter was the worst class.
I do.
Ever.
Everybody agreed.
Yeah. And then there was, like, a Liquipedia report or something like that, and it said, well, maybe sometime... There will be a time when Hunter will not be last.
Yeah, the worst class. And then for the following year and a half, I will hunt you down. Yeah, and you couldn't live
really
with
like,
it.
And there were no changes in the cards back then. It only the combo old style combo beast appeared.
People started playing. I remember Forsen back in the simulator that we used to play on Cockatrice was the one player who played beast. Hunter with the combo. He was like the first player I remember playing that. I don't know if anybody else would, but...
I wasn't aware that Forsen was playing on Cockatrice.
Yeah, if I remember, he did. That's the first interaction I had of him back then from as Forsen SC2. That being said, the next game is going to be Druid versus Warrior. Kolento is going to be playing as Druid versus Lifecoach as Warrior. Again, Something I would have said a while back is Druid wins this, but Grim Patron changes things a bit.
Yep. If there would be an insane Grim Patron on turn, let's say, 5,
yep,
then it might be turned around. But from what we have seen so far, is the fact that the Lifecoach is not playing Enrages.
Right, he's playing 2 unstable ghouls, I think. And either instead or just no Enrages. There have been a lot of variants, you know, of Grim Patron around. It's not yet the deck that's been heavily refined. It still has about, like, usually when a deck is refined, you have about 3 to 4 spots that you can swap.
Yep.
Grim Patron has like 7, where everybody just moves out cards at whim because they feel like it, yep, and it doesn't feel like it's refined yet.
Some versions even don't play Boom, don't play Grommash.
Yeah, and some just play all the legendaries.
Yep. So. Some I saw some playing Pyromancer's Commanding Shout, an example.
Wild Pyromancer is an interesting tech. It's just I feel like it's weird to play in a deck like this because you
it's
can't
like
heal it up, right?
Yeah,
you're trying to go too far in the combo at that point.
That's true. It might kind of help against aggro decks like Zoo because if you play, let's say, Pyromancer into Commanding Shout into Inner Rage Whirlwind.
Yeah, that's crazy. Like you wipe the board, guaranteed.
Yeah.
Yeah. And even if you don't get anything else out of it, at least.
And you still have the Pyromancer on board.
Yeah. 3-1, and it's another threat that they have to handle.
True.
All right. Getting to the game at the moment, we see Lifecoach's Grim Patron Warrior versus Kolento's Druid, who has
no
Wild
Mind
Growth.
Yeah.
Same reaction. Whenever you and I are casting Druid, it seems like we're looking for
oh,
the
look at that! Magically appeared.
Oh, well, that's a card.
I guess you do it on 2-1.
Yeah, without a 4-drop, I think. I think usually you do it every time when you have a 5-drop. But with no 4 or 5, you don't.
Okay.
That's my rule of thumb. If I have 4 or 5, then I do it.
Savage Roar, okay. So you got the combo too.
So basically what you're saying is this is just a matter of time.
It's a clock ticking.
Yeah.
And you have to drop the Frothing Berserker in this situation. There's
and I like it. Option. I think it's a really good time to play it, because you're playing Gnomish afterwards,
mm-hmm,
and both together are a bit of a pain to deal with.
10-5, you have Azure Drake. Then you have Ancient of Law. It's really neat. Now your card draw.
Yeah, Kalento's got all the card draw in the world right now.
The problem is, if you play Gnomish Inventor, it's really weak to swipe.
Yeah, but at least the shade dies, right? And it takes
out
the
entire turn.
No, it doesn't. Well, it has to trade and goes down to 1.
You swipe the Frothing Berserker and it trades for the Gnomish Inventor. It's 3-1.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you have to Cruel Task. Well, I guess you have to Cruel Task for it to die, but...
But there's no swipe. So I guess this turn is Sylvanas or Azure Drake. I guess Sylvanas is not bad.
Yeah, I think Sylvanas is really, really painful to handle. Because you don't want to give away that Frothing at all.
Yep.
Trading it away also feels excruciating. It's a good thing that Lifecoach picked up the Emperor yet for so soon. Because he's got the Warsong, he's got the Patrons, he's got the Cruel Tasks. They're going to go down to 1.
So that's 6 for 8 mana you go, double Cruel Task.
Yeah, this is
charge.
If he gets this done, this could be just a crazy turn.
So you trade for the Sylvanas here. You go with the Gnomish first,
double
then
trade.
You sacrifice the Frothing Berserker, right?
I think so.
And then
is there ever an argument to just punch face really hard? Like you Cruel Task once on your Frothing and go
no,
face
you can't.
And everything.
I feel like you have to. Yeah, you have to sacrifice the board for the Sylvanas, I think.
What if you trade Gnomish and go face for 4? Does that accomplish anything? Probably not. You're still weak to Wrath Swipe. Same problems you had earlier.
The problem is your turn 5 sucks.
Yeah.
You have nothing.
You have no follow.
You have nothing. Literally nothing. Unless you want to play the Taskmaster on the board, and that's it.
Is he going for it? No, he's going to trade.
Yeah.
And the armor up play. Sylvanas forcing Lifecoach to slow down even further. Who would have thought?
And now there will be an Azure Drake, right? Never mind.
Yeah, change of plans, ladies and gents. This could be a very, very quick game.
Yeah, this ends next turn. This ends next turn. There's no way to kill the board, and that deals 14, 19, 21.
It's almost going to be lethal, but
25, 26, 28 damage.
Yeah, it's going to be a little off, but so not enough for it to matter.
It's not enough for lethal next turn, but it's almost that.
Emperor strikes again. I mean, Wildgrove strikes again.
Wildgrove and Emperor.
And Emperor strike again, okay.
And Sylvana. With coin.
Let's make it a team.
What team?
Team Ramp.
Oh, wow.
And Life Coach is going to try. But Kolento doesn't have lethal, right?
No, it's
He's
too off.
He's too off, so...
Too off.
Could that change anything, the matter at hand? I don't think it does. I think you still just punch face really hard.
I think you go with everything and sacrifice the Emperor after that. Or the...
Or your Shade. I think I'd sacrifice the Shade, yeah.
It's like almost no difference.
Except you get 5 coins.
Yeah, okay, maybe that's a bit.
Yeah, I think the 5 coins are worth the keep.
4 coins, don't you?
Right, because you play 2 cards.
Yeah. I guess you go for it. Like, why are you even worrying about anything? You have.
I'm trying to figure out what he's worried about ever, but I can't quite come up with the answer.
Will you lose 7 damage if you trade? What? Didn't do it? Why, bro?
I am legitimately confused.
Yeah. I didn't see that happening. Like,
me neither. Not in 1,000 years.
What if Lifecoach would have the most insane combos?
Yeah, with double
right
execute
now.
And every board wipe in the world. That would have been game
viable.
Right there. But like he doesn't have it, fortunately for Kolento.
Imagine one Inner Rage here.
Yeah, Inner Rage is... Funny enough, Inner Rage would win the game in this hand. Like, it
Maybe
would actually allow him
game.
To wipe the board.
He would be not out of the woods yet, but...
Yeah, but he'd be able to at least stabilize, where right now it's not possible.
He can kill 2 creatures.
Yeah. And get... Actually, he can kill 3 with the Whirlwind, right? Oh, no, Cruel Task, 5. Yeah, he can kill 2 and then get another patron. But he's not going to be able to kill more than that.
Yeah.
Execute would have been needed, and even less mana.
So
oh,
he
wow.
needs to go for that. That sucks.
He's trying to find the execute, is my guess.
Yeah.
He knows he's dead with Emperor staying on the board.
So he's trying to dig for both executes.
Yeah, that is not it. Although Whirlwind and Battle Rage.
So now he goes for 1 execute.
Yeah. He didn't find it?
I have no idea.
Apparently not.
I don't think he has enough time to do that.
Yeah, he's dead anyway. I think he knew it. After 2 turns of Emperor and Druid, I think everybody is aware that they're dead. that's usually the way I go about it. If it lives 1 turn, I'm probably dead.
True.
If it lives 2 turns, I'm dead.
4 mana for Force of Nature and 1 mana for Savage Roar? Yeah, sure.
Probably in a very early phase of Alpha, this was how the game was designed. At some point in the past.
Good that I didn't play it.
Well, I remember Force of Nature used to be 5, so that was already bad enough. But then they actually changed it when they realized how obscene it was. So Kolento's gonna take the win against Life Coach.
The Emperor, man. 10-6 from the top of the deck, Emperor. It looked insanely good for Life Coach.
Yeah.
And then just...
And one Emperor gets played on the board, and everything just snowballs out of control. So he's going to equalize the series 1-1. Both players are still in this, no questions asked. Life Coach will replay his Warrior in the future if Kolento plays another deck. Now, Druid is locked out. Again, Kolento has to win with Priest at some point, and he's not going to do that against Grim Patron.
I guess not.
And I think the lineup from Life Coach is perfect against Priest. He's got his Druid that also wins pretty well. He's got a mage deck that can do okay if it snowballs.
Well, it's mech mage, so it's not so great.
It's not great, but it can do... I think it's weak against Kolento's specific Priest, but 3 out of the 4 decks from Life Coach were countering Priest, so he just has to make sure he doesn't queue up mech mage into it by accident, I guess. Like, when you blind pick effectively at a stage like this in a best of 7, so if he if that does happen, it could be a bit of a problem.
Yeah, we'll just have to see. Like, we know that Kolento will be picking Warlock right now. So yeah. It means we'll see some demon action.
He's right playing mid range, I think. It's not a handlock as a.
He has Sylvanas in his deck and two Void Terrors.
Yeah, Void Terror was the first mid range Warlock deck that I saw when GVG came out. Mm-hmm. Was from Kolento with a Floating Watcher, two Void Terrors. It was like one of the very early versions before it got refined. And then Warlock went all over the place. It was like handlock, mid-range handlock, demon handlock, demons. Yeah. Like it just became 25 different archetypes.
And I really like the handlock with Void Colors.
Void Colors, yeah.
That was really greedy. And in some environments, you could have played that because the rules allowed to be more greedy. Yeah. Like an example, Seed Story Cup. You had the system with ban, like Conquest of Ban.
You could take something out that you knew was bad
for you. So you just ban Hunter and you go with a really greedy handlock.
Yeah.
Like really greedy.
And I think it's nice to be able to adapt to the environments, the meta games that you're going to be playing in. So next up is going to be Warlock versus Mage. So Mech Mage versus the Warlock from Kolento. I think Warlock is usually favored there. I don't think that changed since early GBG.
I don't think that changed
GBG.
At all. Yeah. The Warlock might have a really upper hand. Big upper
a
hand.
Big one, in fact. I think it's really hard for the mage to contest. If the mage gets the snowball early, then it's just a matter of getting fireballs.
Yep.
But aside from that, if they don't get the lead, because they usually both contest the board equally early, and the power of whelming on eggs is a big deal.
And the eggs are kind of a great answer to blast mages.
Blast mage, yeah.
Imp King boss, the same. And then we have Hunted Creepers, which is also okay against everything that mage plays. So it feels kind of bad for the mage player.
It's always felt bad since GVG came out. Mm-hmm. But it might. I don't know if things will change for that matchup. I mean, I'm looking at mage, and they already have like Freeze Mage as a really dominant archetype against Zoo. They're really doing amazingly. But the moment you switch to something like a Tempo Mage, and you accelerate it to Mech Mage, mm-hmm, and then you go full on aggro, everything falls apart against Zoo. Like, it's Freeze Mage or nothing, it feels like. Nothing else seems to stand in the way of them, besides Freeze. So at least they've got that. At least it's one thing.
Nice, bro.
Yeah.
Okay, we're jumping into the game free. Red player wins. That will happen.
Yeah, I bet you it will. I'm sure it will. It's like when the druids, like a druid mirror match, who's going to win? I think the druid will. Yeah.
And by the way, I think that's the battle between the top teams in Hearthstone.
Cloud9 and Nihilum, right?
Yeah. What do we have here?
A great hand is what we have. Kolento with the amazing Haunted Creeper. His Void Terror is going to be so sick. He's done that every game so far. Yep. Every single game, he's had the Nerubian Egg with Void Terror.
Yeah, 2-3, that's insane.
I mean, a 3-5 with a 4-4. Count me in.
Like, it feels that the Mech Mage is just a weaker Zoo.
It does. Yeah, I really feel that way. I'm still trying to come up with the reason why I'd play it over Zoo. And I still can't. It reminds me of...
That's maybe the only reason.
Yeah. Was it Thais that said he didn't like Mentities? Or is that someone else?
I think that was someone else.
Yeah.
So you go with the Neutron? Like Warper and Neutron?
Probably. I don't see a reason why not. Could you ever justify pinging a spider after? There's no way he does that. This is such a terrible play otherwise.
No. There's no way. You have to get more minions on board. It's like the only way you can win against Zoo.
And it's not even guaranteed.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't even say anything. Like,
you have to get Blessed Mages when he still lacks a creature that will benefit from the pings.
Which is almost never.
Second Nerubian Egg. That's nice, but you go
so
with
he's got
Terror.
To figure out, yeah, I was going to say, like, what's the play here? Do you go for Juggler, Abusive, or do you go for the Void?
I think you go for the Void.
Okay.
4-4 minion against Mech Mage, I think that's fine.
No, it's definitely solid.
10-4 for you would be most likely drop Voidcore, a new threat in Mel'Ganis, or Doomguard?
That would probably be...
No one will trade for that.
No one goes in. Because it's too threatening.
Yeah.
If it goes wrong, you'll just lose right away.
And if you trade, you still trade, so you feel kind of bad.
Yeah. So you're not done. And he goes for the Void Terror, getting himself a 3-5 and the 4-4. That's going to put Lifecoach on the ropes.
Second mech warper, well, it's kind of fine.
That's a pretty good draw.
But he likes the mechs in this kind of...
The thing is, I'm curious to know, what do you play? Like Mech Warper Yeti, or do you ever go just Tinkertown? I think the Mech Warper... Fireball. What about Fireball? What to do? I don't like Fireball very much.
Fireball for what? It's like...
You have to keep it for face against Zoo.
Yeah, if you killed the Nurban, it feels like you're fireballing a 2-drop.
Yeah, you're fireballing nothing. No, I think Mech Warper Mechanical Yeti full face is just...
When you think about it, like the combo of Nurban Egg into Void Terror, right?
Mm-hmm.
It feels like the minion that the 4-4 minion says he can't attack the first turn, the second turn.
It is in game, right? Yeah.
But at the same time, you spend 5 mana for 7, 12, 16.
Yeah, you get Ascension. It's crazy what you get from this combo.
Yeah. Like really insane.
And the fun part is, it's been, you know, when you start playing Hearthstone for the first time, you see Void Terror, right? Your first reaction is, this is so awesome. I can do something with Void Terror, but it's just never played. At least not very much. So when you do see a deck like this that incorporates it, it does feel pretty cool. All right, the juggler.
Why juggler?
Get some knives.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, that's how you play the game. You just knife everything.
To be honest, I didn't like the juggler. I would rather play the Voidcore. Like, if you play Voidcore in that board,
you're guaranteed to get...
You're saying, I have a huge demon in my hand.
Yeah.
It's like, that's what you say. And then you can bluff your opponent.
Yeah, he's never going to trade into it. Yeah. And then you get
no way he's going to trade.
And now... This is going to be a good opportunity for Mirror Entity, is my guess.
You trade for the Knife Juggler, right? No, for the 4-2. Well, maybe.
I like the Juggler, because the 4-2 already dies to what's left.
So first you play Tinkertown Technician.
Find something good.
If you find an example, let's say Prison Coolant, Emergency Coolant, that would be cool.
Time Rewinder.
Not useful at all.
Yeah, not quite now, at least. Might come in handy. It's like the worst spare part for most situations. I guess Hunter's the only ones that are like, yeah.
Against Freeze Mages. You kill that right. Doomsayer.
And then, yeah. We're reversing switch, right?
Yeah.
Time Rewinder.
Oh, Time Rewinder, sorry, yeah.
Yeah, Time Rewinder is the one where you play Archmage, then you return to your hand, and all you got for that 8 mana play was a Fireball.
Well, it kind of, you know, works against... it works with low taps.
Yeah.
It works with, let's say, Tinkertown Technicians for additional parts.
Yeah, it does work sometimes. Can't say I've been overly impressed with it. Lifecoach was leading the board, and then Abusive Sergeant came up.
Piled True Rider. Well, you'd play that, kill the Abusive Sergeant, and go face with everything.
I think this is the point where Lifecoach has to go full face.
Yes.
This is where you have to turn on the aggressive gears, because you can't start playing defensively. You have no way to tap. Like, it's not like you can draw cards the way the Warlock can.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess there's a point, and this is probably the point, where sometimes, or somehow, Mech Mage feels like a War Zoo.
Yes.
This is like the perfect example. We've reached that stalemate point where suddenly Zoo feels like it's just designed better.
Yeah, because of the life tap. It's like, okay, I guess I draw 2 cards at 1 turn.
Yeah, exactly. And the Mage... I mean, they can compensate by having phase burst with frost bolts and fireballs, but it's hard for them to get them and not be under pressure. Lifecoach thinking about the Pilot Shredder ping play.
What about fireballing Nurban and pinging this one I don't think that I don't like that at all.
Yeah, I think you still do have to get a Shredder out. Like, minions are obviously, like, the reason as well that Zoo is better than Mechmage is minions are more impactful than spells very often. Give me the choice between a 4-attack minion and a 4-damage spell, I'll put down the 4-attack minion most of the time.
There's the Doomguard.
And that works with the Void Terror very well. You eat up that Snowchugger, then you pop the Void Terror on the left. Get yourself a free Doomguard to attack right now.
What did you say? So you trade first, right, for the minions?
With Snowchugger, yeah. And then you eat up the Void Terror, the Void Caller with the Void Terror.
That's kind of insane.
Yeah, that draw from Kolento was actually really sick. And he curves with Dr. Boom right afterwards.
Wow.
This is just...
Yeah, this is not what you want to see if you're life coach right now. Oh, man. All right, wait.
It's still a lot of damage.
Yeah, there is still quite a bit of damage left.
I didn't like the tap, to be honest.
Yeah, I don't think it was necessary.
Yeah.
I really don't think that Kolento's tap was necessary
like
in this position.
Now he trades for the Party Shredder, right?
You could kill 4-4 and 2-1 if you wanted.
No, you have to kill the Party Shredder. That's the only mech he has.
Yeah, for Blast Mage?
Yeah.
It's so awful, though, to play around Blast Mage here. You know there's two spare parts, so like one card left.
No, okay. That's really weird.
Felguard!
There's no way... There's no way Lifecoach will, like, not go face in this situation.
Yeah.
He has to play the spare part, and the Chugger, and ping face.
Every turn until he just gets the win. If he can. Like, that's the only out he's got. Is ping face, over two turns he wins with fireballs, I think. Whirling Blade, you might even go with, like, Snowchugger with the Whirling Blades on top.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, just like
Whirling Blade on Palto Shredder and you go 5 to the face.
And pray.
And ping. Ping with Chugger. So if you top deck this fireball, you win.
Yeah. It's the only way you're going to get this. Is by putting the opponent on fireball death.
Yep.
I mean, you could actually have like two turns. Because the board is still threatening, Kolento is trading everything away.
Yeah, but you get... because Kolento tapped...
Yeah, you get a bit
He's giving you the chance to win next turn.
Yeah. No, but that's the thing. Like, he gets two draws. I think Lifecoach is going to have next turn and possibly the next one before he's completely dead.
Is he really thinking about fireballing 6-5?
If he does that, I'll be very surprised.
Yeah.
Very surprised.
He's trading, what?
Well, I'm very surprised.
Yes, I'm also
I mean, I don't even know what to say. Now he has no draw. Versus a Warlock.
Yeah, I didn't
this
like
is over.
That at all.
Like, this is over. This is just done.
I really didn't like that at all. Like, even if he gets Antonidas, it doesn't do much.
There's always a possibility, I just don't see it.
Shredder?
As a very likely outcome.
What do you now?
You face.
You face and play Shredder and ping the bomb, right? Or ping the face?
Yeah, you ping the face. Like, I don't even know. You could ping the bomb, I guess, if you wanted. Nice job, bomb. Another good one. Another good one here. Whoa.
And he's tapping.
Kolento is very tap happy. After
well,
the
he
first
knows
fireball,
that's
there's no point.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
So we know that Lifecoach wouldn't have won because he didn't have. Like
the fireball,
the fireball draw. But if he gets the fireball now,
wow,
he
would have won the game. Yeah,
he would have won.
This
the game.
This would have been the game for Lifecoach if he'd gone for the one chance at lethal. I think the play he made, although it felt safe, was
it
not
was the
all
losing
in.
Play.
It wasn't an all in enough.
It was the losing play because there's like Void Walkers. There's Elephant of Argus.
Yeah, yeah. The amount of taunts on the board will always stop your minions from doing what you want at this point. The only way you won was through fireballs. And we knew that, right? Like, it was pretty obvious. And I think even he did. It's just that he didn't feel safe leaving the board as it was.
Yeah. And now Elephant of Argus will just seal the deal.
Life tap, still.
Well, after you saw two fireballs, like... Whatever.
What do I care, right?
Yeah.
Maybe Archmage comes out and then Time Rewinder gets back
with
to
what?
The
you need a
Like, you send it back to your spare parts, to your hands, to hide it away. And that will be game number three for Kolento. Who's going to find the lethal right away. So Warlock versus Mage, again, you know, very, wouldn't say one-sided necessarily, but it's favored for the Warlock.
Yeah, but Lifecoach had a chance to win this game.
It's,
well, he was at 28 life, right, when there was a full board of the of Kolento, and Kolento was kind of forced to trade first.
He had to, because otherwise he was dead, fireball.
So he was saving his damage, like, a lot. By a lot. And then in two turns after, he top decked the second fireball. So
he was really close to getting it, and there was no other way unless Kolento got nothing for three turns.
Yeah,
unless Kolento got nothing, and I'm talking
already
like
two cards in his hand.
Yeah, like there's no way Kolento is not gonna have something to play. Yeah. So Lifecoach, I think, making a slight misplay. In this matchup, I say slide because when you're in the game, sometimes you just look at the board state, you try to trade, and you don't necessarily calculate this, like how what your outs are. And at some point, against Zoo as Mech Mage or a mid-range Warlock, you have to realize I have no outs.
Yep.
I have none.
If you're like counting on top decking a Blast Mage, you can count on top decking Fireball. At the
exactly,
same point.
As much, pretty much. Yeah. So it's, I think he could have taken this if he'd gone for the all-in. Statistically unlikely, but still the best chance he had.
Yeah. Because you can also count on drawing Dr. Boom. That's the same chance as drawing the
Fireball. Right,
ball.
You could have also gone but that much.
I guess Fireball gets lethal and Dr. Boom doesn't get you lethal.
Yeah.
So
unfortunate for Lifecoach that I don't know if he realized at the end that he could have gotten the win with Fireball.
Sure
I'm pretty sure he did. He's usually
sure
calculating
he's
and stuff.
He's aware of that.
But the second game is going to go to Kolento, who's going to be up 2-1 against Lifecoach in those finals. Lifecoach can still play Mech Mage, but he's going to have to go up against Priest now. And
Priest and
Warrior. You don't want to run into Warrior, and you don't want to run into Priest.
Well, against Warrior, it's not essentially so bad.
Oh, it's actually pretty... like, Rim Patron has a pretty good... a good
well,
chance.
Well, okay, yeah, no, scratch that. Never mind.
Yeah, we're not against Control Warrior, sometimes you get a good Snow Chugger in the game.
There's
over.
No Brawls that...
Lifecoach's Mech Mage could be the weak spot in his lineup at the moment. Kind of like Sho's lineup, actually. Who also contained a mage who didn't do
much.
Yeah,
the Mech Mage seems to be lacking.
Yeah, it always did. Even during GVG, you could tell it was like, it felt like a bad Zoo while you were playing it.
Yeah,
but
you know why? What? It lacked the card draw.
Yeah, nothing.
It's like top decking mode every single turn.
Yeah.
Unless you play like one Azure Drake.
Yeah, you play one Drake in your deck. The moment you start making room for draw, you're like, why am I not playing Freeze Mage instead? it's just... like, Temple Mage is a good, like, in-between, but... I guess so.
Like, I didn't play Mech Mage for, like, I guess almost a month now.
Yeah, and I don't... when I see it, I'm not impressed.
Yeah.
I was impressed before Zoo was a thing, like, again. And now that I see Zoo come back in, I'm just... I feel like Mech Mage... did his job for the time that it did it, and it was enabled by Mech Warper and Blast Mage, you know, making giving the mage the unfair cards, but I don't think they have the most unfair aggro cards anymore.
Yeah, well, the only draw that can punish some players, I mean other players, is like double Mech Warper opener.
Perfect opener, but that's you could play Mech Warrior with double Mech Warper, and you would probably still punish the opponent.
I feel just
right?
Mech Shaman is better at doing that stuff than Mech
with Fellreaver now being rampant and very viable.
Fellreavers and Zap-O-Matics.
Yeah.
The Paul Mace is...
with you buff a Zap-O-Matic to 5-4, it's not answered, win the game. Even an Anoyotron, anything is just
that's
crazy.
That's a problem with Mech Mage. It lacks a weapon. Because the weapon maintains board control, and it's like a 2-for-1.
So I think this is kind of the reason maybe why some of the like the versions that came out of Temple, Stormoran, the Blinktron... right?
Yeah.
Blinktron was really good in Mech Mage for a while, but it got phased out by a lot of players.
It's like a card draw, which is always damage.
Yeah, and it furthers
sometimes it's like one damage, but
the opponent gets Gorehowl, you get a 1-4.
Or a Doomhammer. Yeah.
And then he's a druid and he's playing Spiteful Smith and you're forcing and then you freak out and you're like, what is this? And why am I playing against you? Your deck is so bad. Why are you winning? Oh man, this is like the most perfect thing. All right, so Lifecoach is going to be moving on to his Druid deck, it seems, which means against Priest and Warrior from Kolento, possibly. This is probably a good...
not bad.
It's not a bad one.
Yeah.
But still, in Conquest format, it comes down to that last deck. And if Mech Mage is the last deck, this is probably going to be very tough.
Yeah. We'll have to see how it goes.
Yeah. Do you think Kolento will queue up Priest or Warrior first?
I'm thinking about it. It's like... doesn't really make a difference, I would say.
Because he's going to be facing either Druid, Warlock, okay. Either Druid, Mage, or Warrior. So Priest versus Druid. A matchup that we said Kolento, you know, that was pretty bad for the Priest, but Kolento, every time he seems to play against a Druid, does pretty well. So I'm having to guess that he could pilot the deck to victory. But Wild Growth is the big thing. Like, if Lifecoach finds Wild Growth, this is going to be...
If there will be a Life Growth.
Life growth confirmed.
There will be a Wild Growth. It changes the dynamic of the whole.
Yeah, duel. The whole Hearthstone doesn't make sense. Like, once you start giving a player one extra mana crystal, you're like, oh, this game just doesn't make sense anymore. Like, you can't even like comprehend. Everything about your tempo plays is thrown off.
It's like you play a football match and one team has 12 players and the other one has 11.
Yeah, and one of them has a basketball. Like, something just doesn't make sense on one side.
Oh, look,
all right, getting
innovate.
To the game, we see double innervate in Lifecoach's hand, which we said that before. This sometimes backfires when you go all in on a play and you have no card draw. Like, if you don't have Ancient of Lore with a hand like this, you just...
Would you keep double innervate in that situation?
Yeah, the four attack minions that you get from it is just stupid.
It can be Dr. Boom, right?
Yeah, you could get Doctor 2. If he finds Dr. Boom off the top. I don't think you could even play it, though. It doesn't make sense.
He goes with the Azure Drake.
Yeah.
So powerful against the Priest, 10-1.
Kalento's face, oh wait, what? I need to wake up now.
At least it's not Dr. Boom.
Yeah.
And you have the Wrath for the Pyromancer. Like, with the card draw.
Yeah, it's perfect. You draw a card off the Drake, it's just perfect here for Lifecoach. But Kolento can't play anything. Oh, wow.
Well, I guess you kind of...
You punch face.
Yeah, but what I wanted to say is, like, I should have kept the innervates.
Yeah, well, when you see Emperor, you think to yourself, I could have gotten infinite innervate. The only weakness is that if you coin out, innervate, Emperor, Shadow or Death... Your game plan is dead.
Mm-hmm,
you got 3-for-1, you have no follow-up, and you're pretty much messed up for the rest of the game.
Okay, so this will be met with Ref for 2.
And Ref for 2.
Coin hero power, I would say.
Yeah? Don't you just double Ref for 2 for the sake of it? No, I think coin hero power is better. Or
well,
you
maybe,
just Ref and
no,
keep turn 4 for...
It depends on the first Ref.
Yeah.
If the first Ref gets you a 4-drop... Then you hero power. If it gets you something else that is not usable next turn, then you wrath it.
I like keeping coin for turn 5 though with the Druid
of
Claw.
Oh, he didn't.
Yeah, with Druid of Claw, like you're getting a really sick another curve, and the Priest has zero ways to answer.
Okay, you're right. You're right
until he has Arcanine Circle, like right now, this is not going to be good.
I guess you're right, yeah. It's more important to not gamble on getting a 4-drop.
Yeah, after you've lost 2 innervates, you have to play it very safe. Because it's the cheat card.
Mm-hmm.
If you've already used your 2 cheats, it's just a really big problem.
But now you can go ref, draw, kill. Or just ignore the board and you go with...
I almost want to say ignore, but then again, I'm looking at this and that's really painful.
So you drop the Pelter Shredder, go face?
How often is that wrong when you have Coin Emperor?
The problem is the fact that there can be a Shadow Madness.
No, I don't like that. I think you have to go for the draw now with the Wrath.
So if Kolento sacrifices the Pyromancer into the Pallet Shredder and gets a 3-2 from that...
No, I like the Wrath play a lot more. Yeah, this is obviously the one best play.
Swipe.
Oh, wow.
Swipe Perino for 5 damage. This might be
balance,
really, really important. Because now if Kolento plays Pyromancer, Fault Steal, Swipe will deal 5 damage to the face and kill the Pyromancer. So that's 9 damage.
It's just going to be like leftover damage that takes care of the 3-2. So.
Oh, right, never mind. The paramesser will be...
It's crazy. It's just perfect.
Dr. Boom and Severor.
And Kolento is forced to play the Wild Pyro. I wonder if Lifecoach will be playing Coin Emperor Thorsen or... Oh, wait. Yeah, I think you do that. Now they found combo, you can get your combo out very soon.
Yeah, if you play Emperor now, you can combo...
2 turns from now, yeah.
2 turns from that. I guess...
I'd do it. Because then next turn you can just go to the Claw Phase or Swipe Phase. Like, pick your choice.
What about... Druid of the Claw Phase now?
Then Emperor and then Curve combo. Yeah, you know what? That's even stronger. You hit 8 right now. If you wanted. Do you ever consider swiping right now instead of playing the Druid? Maybe that's even better.
I was thinking, like, the swipe phase was my initial game.
Actually, I think it's the best one here. Like, I'm trying to go overboard with creativity, but just go, like, swipe phase, hit for 9, then Savage War next turn win.
Yeah.
It's, like, the most boring play in the universe, but it's the most effective one. Like, what do I do, SM Orc?
I guess that's it. There's nothing you can do.
Yeah, welcome to Druid, ladies and gents.
You just lost to a double innovate Azure Drake in one.
The Drake does, what, like 17,000 damage?
You know what? What's even funnier?
Not even mad. What?
That the Ogre Brute would have almost done the same.
Yeah? Ogre Brute would have probably done almost the same thing, aside from the fact that you didn't get the swipe for 5, but it would have been pretty close. So Lifecoach, equalizing series 2-2 in the Grand Finals. This is actually possibly going to be a 4-3. In either player's favor.
Well, this was a really fast game.
Yeah.
It took like 3 minutes.
Yeah. Well, the other one with Druid as well, when Kolento got the Wild Growth.
It
went like, oh, Emperor, all right, let's play this. And
that's, Emperor, bam!
Yeah. I think Druid is the only class where you find Emperor and you just slam it.
Yeah.
Like, you think about it in many classes, but Druid seems to be the one class where you know it's so unfair that you have it, that you just have to play it. Like, other classes, it's generally, like, they have very specific combos they want to get, but Druid, it's such an all-in every single time.
Especially when you have this whole combo in your hand.
Yeah, 7 mana, 14 damage. That, there's nothing to say about that.
Seems like an okay draw.
Yeah. So, next match is going to be Warrior versus Warrior, both players playing their Grim Patrons.
The mirror matches are very interesting, unless someone gets an Emperor out.
I think
then Emperor... Then it's kind of one-sided.
It's like the same thing as Druid versus Druid when one gets a Wild Growth.
Yeah, similar.
That's how it feels because they're both going for the same game plan and then one of them gets a discount on everything and suddenly, oh, well, my Executes are free, my Whirlwinds are free, my Warsong Commanders cost me 2 mana and then everything seems to just snowball out of control for that.
My Inner Rages are -1.
Yeah, add mana. So I get a coin.
Yeah, what for free.
You know what's funny, though, is when I realized that Emperor actually doesn't... Like, it reduces the cost of 0-cost spells to -1.
Because when they're more expensive, like with
somebody plays Lotheb. Like, I had a preparation that, like, Emperor stayed 3 turns on the board, and he played Lotheb, and my prep was 2, and I'm like, wait, this is a coin. I could actually play it. And it actually gave me mana on a spell. So when I realized that, I thought it was...
Okay, that's interesting. That's something you want to know.
Yeah, if you ever run into the circumstance, of course, but... Yeah. So warrior versus warrior. Do you think the warrior wins?
I guess the warrior wins. The red warrior.
Yeah, the red warrior wins. Yeah.
The red Sonya.
There's no more blue anyway.
Well, there's blue on the Cloud9 logo and there's kind of a red-ish hue on Nihilum's logo.
Yeah. So what's the last match? We have Priest still on Kalento's side, right? Priest is going to have to go up against Mechmage at the very least. If Kolento wins with Warrior, Lifecoach is going to have to beat Priest with Mechmage.
Not necessarily, right?
He can Kolento queue beats up the Warrior.
Mage against... Like, if Lifecoach wins with the Warrior now, then he can queue up
Mage
the Mage against,
Warrior, against
the Warrior.
Yeah, but if Kolento wins now, Lifecoach has to win with Mage.
Yeah, that's true.
And that's going to be really problematic, because Kolento plays very well when he plays Priest, and Mechmage isn't really favored, so...
Especially when it's come to a situation when Shadow Madness will net you a 2-for-1.
Yeah, usually. And it can deny Mad Scientist. You can get so much value out of it. All right, getting to the game. We see that Kolento is playing the Unstable Ghoul version of
Grim
Patron as
well. And he has the coin. which is really important.
One extra card.
Decks. And one extra
and one
mana.
Yeah, exactly. And one mana for combo.
It doesn't really matter if you have the turn first. Like, the coin makes the outcome almost even when it comes to that. And you have the one card draw more, which is way more valuable.
For combo.
Because it affects not only the fact that you have one more card, like, in general, less in your deck. I mean, one less card in your deck. But also, it alternates your game plan from the beginning of the game, because you have more cards, so you know what
yeah,
you
what's
really
left
have,
exactly,
and you know what to do because you have
more information.
Information.
You can tell the difference in the way you play when you're second, when you're playing combo. I realize a lot of the time you'll be. It feels like that one extra card gives you. You can find, you know, an Acolyte of Pain earlier.
Yeah,
that's yeah. It looks like it's one extra card, but it's much more than that, in the way that it plays.
And there's an Emperor. Wow.
Well, Kolento here finding the Emperor Thorsen very early, and you can bet he's not going to get punished for a little while.
Yeah. And now Lifecoach is in a situation when he kept the Battle Rage, so he doesn't want to armor up.
Yeah.
There's a in this matchup, no one plays a creature until turn 4.
Yeah. It takes a long time, so you want to get, you know, you want to get your Fire War Axe into something. To get one damage, just one.
Yeah.
But it's very unlikely to happen.
I guess you play the Fairy Works anyway.
Yeah, just get it out. You're going to get possibly a Corsair next turn. It's kind of a waste because you're losing it to a weapon.
Yeah. And in this situation, you didn't lose mana and you didn't gain armor for the Battle Rage, so that's okay.
Oh man, finds the Grim Patron. So, coin Emperor into two patrons.
That's insane.
If he finds a Warsong Commander in the meantime, this could get very nasty.
You don't want to play the Dread Corsair anyway.
No, not. I don't
There's
think
There's no reason to play the Dread Corsair.
No, you're just feeding it to the weapon. And giving him Battle Rage value. I remember the day where Battle Rage was so useless that nobody really
wanted
to play it.
I was playing it. I am not hearing you. I was playing.
Yeah, but back in the aggro warrior days, right?
Yeah.
Those days are long gone. The life coach is thinking, do I armor up?
I guess so.
Or do I armor up?
But that's the awkward situation in this deck. If you armor up, you can't battle rage. So, you know.
You have to attack into something that has more than 2 attack. Reminds me of the question that people were asking when Hearthstone came out. They had no idea, but does a do you take damage from weapons that are on the opponent's side, like the armed enemies? Do I take damage from them?
No, it's like represented by the
weapon being closed, right?
Being closed, yeah. Weapon. Yeah, I bet there will be a weapon that will be open during opponent's turn.
A shield, probably.
Might be.
Yeah, a good shield for warrior
like
where
a
it deals.
Thorn shield.
Yeah, thorn shield reflects damage or something. That would be really nice to see. It fits very nicely. Now, life coach gets the acolyte out, but it's not really that big of a deal for the warrior because he draws as much as he can. Draw one card here, one card there is good enough, especially when you've got the emperor like Kolento does. I think life coach is going to be forced to play his gnomish inventor.
I think so. You have to play it.
Mm-hmm.
You kill the Acolyte, you play the Knowledge Inventor. That's it.
He will need to find Emperor to contest this. Like.
And now the problem is that he can't deal with the Knowledge Inventor. It's like, okay, I have Fury War Axe. Do I use the Unstable Ghoul right now? He has like... No, there's no way he can kill the Unstable Ghoul and play an Patron.
But yeah, he can play both.
Yeah. So that's not a big problem, like I thought it
I
would
guess
be.
Kolento just plays Gnomish Inventor here, right?
Yeah, I guess so.
You just keep drawing until you can get turn 5 Emperor and just get a really solid... Or maybe you wait until you find the combo pieces you want to play. Before you play Emperor. Because that is literally the card that's going to seal the game for you.
Well, you have half of it.
Yeah, but you're missing... Like, if you can get cheap Whirlwinds... I don't even know if he runs Inner Rages, so maybe those Whirlwinds will be even more important.
I like how you said cheap Whirlwinds when they are freed.
Yeah, but like when they're one mana in Grim Patron, it's always expensive. It feels expensive sometimes.
There's the execute.
Oh man, zero mana execute.
Feels strong. Strong. Sorry. I forgot the nerd language. Strong.
Strong. Strong. Yeah, strong.
Too strong.
Too strong. Too strong, 5 me.
Yeah. And
Alright, same thing. I guess you just... Well, Death's Bite probably makes more sense with Dread.
Death's Bite. Do you like Grim Patrons?
Do you even play Dread? I don't think so.
If you go into Death's Bite this turn, so you can draw multiple cards next turn.
Yeah.
With Battle Rage and Acolyte of Pain, but they have to sacrifice Death's Bite.
Yeah, I don't think
it's not necessarily bad.
It's not bad because you can at least kill the Grim Patron.
Yeah,
I mean the Emperor that comes out.
Yeah, the Whirlwind also.
No, I don't mind this. Life Coach is just gonna hold on for a really good Battle Rage.
Mm-hmm.
And it might pay off. Now Kalento's got to be asking himself if he wants to play Emperor on this hand. And my gut feeling is no. Because he can get it, you know, on curve next turn instead. And keep the coin for the combo.
Yeah.
It's gonna be just crazy, but
okay, never mind, he goes for it.
Alright, cheap patrons abound, but there's very little to do with this. He's gonna get himself a Grim Patron plus Taskmaster, and this is usually,
you know what's funny?
Hard to recover
from
as a
warrior. The fact that when you see Emperor, like on the board, you're not even thinking about what are the possibilities now.
Because yeah, you just stop.
Too many possibilities.
Yeah, it's too many. The combinations just go up way too high.
Oh, that's that's a good card, I would say. But still, you go first with the Battle Rage.
Maybe I trade my Gnomish away. Like, slam the 5/5, trade away Gnomish, then attack face with Acolyte on board instead of Battle Raging.
It nets you only one card.
Only one card, yeah.
And you lose the charge from the durability. So if you get an execute...
The thing is, you lose the 2/1 if you attack with Death's Bite, so...
No.
You have to start with Battle Rage, yeah.
Look at that. I know. Battle Rage first, you can get an execute, then you slam, right?
Yeah, no, you're right. It's a good play. It's definitely a good play.
Okay, so he goes for the Battle Rage afterwards. He will kill the Emperor in this situation.
Yeah. Which I think for him right now is good enough. He needs to find the combo right away.
He would get the execute. Armor Smith? No, he wouldn't have it. He wouldn't have the execute, so okay.
Now Kolento, still no Warzone Commander in sight.
I feel you just dropped the patron. Drop the ghoul? Drop
the
ghoul.
Yeah, I think that's the play. It puts too much pressure on the opponent.
And there's no execute for the second patron, you know?
And this is the big weakness of... Like, we were talking about this in Mirror Match. Whoever gets the first patrons usually takes the game because warriors have no more than one damage AoEs.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what they fuel on to win. So you can't really feed them any of that.
I don't think Lifecoach is a way out of this.
Charge minion, perhaps. Warzone Commander patron next turn, charge the job.
What do you want to do with that?
No, he could actually kill the ghoul and then spawn his own Grim Patrons to counter the other Grim Patrons. It's like a hopeless chain of...
Yeah, but you die next turn, I would say. Like, it's...
So I think you have to slam the Grim Patron that's up there. That's already established.
What about...
The 5/2, and then you get... You could go frothing and then slam the other one. And hope that doesn't backfire too hard.
Yeah, that's also one of the plan.
Yeah, you can even, you know, Fire War Axe the 3/3 on the far right. Frothing, slam the 5/2, Fire War Axe the Dread Corsair. And if he wants to spawn more 1/1s, then you could actually get it done yourself with the Grim Patrons afterwards. I think there's a way for Life Coach to stabilize, but... It's gonna take everything.
Well, next turn he can combo out
Patron,
like
with
really
the war song.
Hard. Yeah. So he needs to live the next turn.
Alright, he's gonna go for the Grim Patron spawn. I'd be really surprised, but it's possible.
Attacking the ghoul doesn't achieve anything.
Yeah, it actually makes things worse. Right now, it just makes things so much worse, it feels.
Oh, and he cursed that makes sense. Because you want the ghoul to be popped next turn.
Yeah, with your Grimms.
Yeah, with your Grimms now.
Kolento. Probably.
You can draw two cards. That's definitely not bad. Gromash and Execute. Execute is useless for now.
It's very good against other Grim Patrons because it's your best way to cleanly kill them, but it's not exactly amazing, so, but it gets a huge damage burst here.
You go face, you don't play the Acolyte, and you play the weapon and go face.
Yeah. You just put as much pressure, you're going to win with Grom anyway. So.
Yeah.
Life Coach, under the gun. Can he win with the Frothing? Can he win with a Frothing Berserker here?
How much damage is that?
Warsong, Cruel Task, Frothing.
That's
he may have calculated it, I don't know.
6, 12.
I think he has it.
That's lethal, right?
Yeah, with the extra Whirlwind.
Wow. That's so insane.
What a crazy.
That's so insane, that's lethal. That's three Whirlwinds effects. And Kolento, look at Kolento's face.
Yeah.
He's like,
ghoul has been his downfall.
This is why I dislike the ghouls in mirror matches. It's like awful.
Yeah, you give your opponent what he needs, as I said. Yeah. Like we said that earlier, it's the biggest liability in mirror matches. And we're proven right in this specific case where Life Coach gets the steal, or what feels like a steal of a
just
win.
Like, it was, if there wouldn't be the ghoul on board, there's no chance he would have won.
No chance at all. So Life Coach's setup for the
25
frothing.
25 damage.
Oh, man. This Berserker is frothing. Life Coach is casually sipping on espresso like nothing ever happened. Just a very casual win, right? I mean, welcome to Grim Patient Warrior. If you can't get in here, then I guess it's time for a little blood.
I guess people have to adjust for the mirror matches.
This, like, the ghoul doesn't achieve much against
it. It does not enough. Anything.
And it's worse for mirror match.
Yeah. It's only usable when you have charge.
Yeah, it's the best time. It's the only time, really.
Yeah. Yeah.
I haven't really been able to. I guess against Face Hunter, we've mentioned that it's good, but that's like the one matchup where
and
it
you're
shines.
Already good.
Yeah.
With already good against Face Hunter, so it's not so needed in that matchup. And against Zoo, it's not needed at all, I would say. It's like.
Right. Yeah.
Whatever. Right. So. I guess it's the one card that you simply just cut away from the list.
Yeah, you might be able to try to find suitable replacements. I think it's a really like debatable flex spot for Warrior.
Yeah.
Now, Mage versus Priest is going to be coming up next. It's going to be the Mech Mage from Life Coach versus the Priest from Kolento. We know the Priest is generally favored, so I would venture to say Priest is going to take it. But Mage is also...
Mage against
Warrior,
Compassion.
If somehow... Life Coach wins, he seals it.
Well,
he takes the match. And if he loses versus Priest, as is typically common, because Kolento is a really strong Priest player, if Kolento wins, then it's going to come down to Grim Patient Warrior versus Mech Mage. Yeah. And that
Thank
is
you, Captain
just,
Obvious. It's like, if Life Coach wins this game, he wins the match. It's like,
Yeah. Well, the game, there's a difference between game and match, right? Game point and match.
It's already 3 a.m., right?
3 a.m. probably. I mean, I can't even.
Yeah, I'm not. I don't even want to check it. Like, you know.
What is sleep?
We cast for 8 hours, I think, now.
I haven't really taken a break, and I have to say it's been a few hours, and I've been awake since like 8 a.m., so I'm literally going around the clock right now, and you can probably tell from the casting. No problem, though. You'll forgive us, I'm sure. You will forgive us.
So, this might be. The last game of the match.
It could be, yeah. If Kolento doesn't get his early, like, the ability to counter the snowball effect of Mech. Because like, we complain against Mech Mage about how, it's worse than Zoo. And it may be all that.
Mm-hmm.
But once it has a foothold on the board, if you can't just take it away, there's no way you're going to win. Like, the damage output per turn is just crazy good.
Yeah. If Kolento lacks the early game cards.
Yeah. He's got so many, though. He's got Shadow Madness. Yeah. He plays Shadow Word Pain, double Wild Pyro, Shrinkmeister as well for the combinations. So.
But this time, Life Coach has the coin. And this is also important. Like, when you play Mech Mage, you kind of want to get the coin.
Mech Warper makes that a lot better. Even.
Yeah.
All right, so two snow chuggers. Okay, that's pretty.
I guess you...
I think you keep Circle for Akinai. You just want that as Kolento.
Yeah. As life coach, I would say you only keep the snow chugger.
How often do you throw Dr. Boom and Spider Tank back? Pretty much every
Dr.
time.
Dr. Boom always, but Spider Tank?
It kills the North Shires.
That's a good point.
It dies to injured Blade Master, though.
I have no idea if Lifecoach threw that back. Like, it looked like he would throw that back, but I'm not sure. But he has a Cop Master, turn one, which is really, really a great help.
Yeah. There's no Holy Smite in Kolento's list. As far as we've seen, I haven't seen one yet.
Yep.
A very popular card to put in Priest on Ladder, but not right here.
I guess you have to go for it, right?
What feels awful is you really want to get an amazing coin turn, and it's going to mean that your coin is going to have to be a Blast Mage on turn 3. Most of the time, that's how you look at it.
Shrinkmaster's not bad.
That's a good way to counter the early game.
Yeah, just trade.
Oh, wow. Okay, that's a better coin play. If he wants to go for that. Do you play Spider Tank or you just go for Snow Chugger?
I think you play Snow Chugger trade.
Yeah, I think I like that a bit better, because every other play you have is going to make your turn 4 a lot weaker.
You can't allow Priest to have an option to buff his creature with Power Shield, an example, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, of course. You have to trade. That's pretty obvious.
But I kind of fear that Lifecoach will go face now.
No,
he's
no
contemplating
way.
Too much. Like, I've seen that before. We actually cast that game when Lifecoach was really punished by not trading, but he plays now.
Yeah. There's a few games that, like, a lot of people make the mistake sometimes of not necessarily evaluating well. And I think a lot of players, the way you pinpoint how good they are at the game is when they make those decisions. Mm-hmm. How well they actually decide to trade at times that otherwise would seem like they're not worth it.
So now you can play around Shadow Madness.
Yeah, I guess you've got the answers.
So I guess you would play the Pelt Shredder, right?
I think that's probably the best option. The only way for it to really get punished is Shrinkmaster Cabal much later on, and you've already seen one Shrink.
If you play the Spider Tank, and then there's the Shadow Madness, you lose the Snow Chugger, and your Spider Tank is being frozen for 2 turns.
Yeah. Do you lose that much, though? Is that big of a deal?
I think so.
It puts it in Nova range, so yes, it is a big deal, I guess. But it passes the turn from Kolento, gives you back the initiative again. Uh-oh.
Oops.
Yeah, indeed.
I still think you Shadow Madness this.
Yeah.
Turn four might be too good for the Mech Mage to ping a 3-1 creature. That's like most of the time it's perfect.
Yeah, it's just a perfect time. 2 drop plus that. There goes the freeze. It's going to stall a little bit until he wants to get the Akinai clear. That Circle of Healing with Akinai is the most important clear in the Priest deck.
Yeah, now we drop just the Pelted Shredder and pass the turn. There's nothing else, I would say. And for Kolento, it doesn't look great either, because if...
I like his hand, though. He's got Sylvanas into Dr. Boom. Like, these hands really...
Why would you play that? Instead of Piloted Shredder.
Uh-oh, the overextension is going to be really heavily punished here. He's going to even be able to get the Power Word Shield on the Akinai.
Yep.
Wow, that is going to stop a Mech Mage dead in his tracks.
That looks like a game for me.
Well, it's not quite over. I mean, there's always a possibility. But at 28 health, this is going to be an uphill battle for Lifecoach at this point.
Now he has to... Frostbolted and play Mad Scientist. Then next turn is Sylvanas, and you have no out on that.
Yeah, you have to trade away in Demantity, but you're not going to be fed too much. I thought Lifecoach's play would be a bit slower. I thought he would play one Shredder, then pass turn. And,
yeah, that would be my play too.
Yeah.
Like, if he keeps the coin so long, I would say you keep it for the Antonidas or for Boom Doctor. Yeah. Doctor Boom.
Against a priest, I think Antonidas is the best time to play it. There's very few other times where you get really good value out of it. At best, you get a slight tempo advantage, but not a massive one.
Yeah.
Antonidas is the way to win.
Second Power Ward Shield? Nah, you just play Sylvanas and go face.
You heal your Alcanai, obviously.
Nice move, bro.
I play Hearthstone. Actually, you could buff it up with Power Chill and ping after what comes out of it. But that's like a complete... You might as well play Sylvanas, right? Yeah, that's probably the better play. And Kolento disagrees.
Okay, that's interesting. So he wants to trade.
Probably. And then heal.
Oh, wow. That's a huge whiff.
Yeah, Life Coach with the worst possible card. Almost.
And back-to-back Med Scientist.
Yeah.
Not good at all. And he lacks the mech.
No mech for Blast Mage. Mad Scientist will give one rare entity, probably not enough to really be useful. Now, Life Coach throwing away a Frostbolt. It's gonna get negated immediately. And Kolento instantly playing Dr. Boom.
I don't blame him at all.
Playing Dr. Boom?
Yeah, well, at least the Ancient Watcher might eat the bombs.
Yeah, well, I guess it's actually, like, it's not the absolute worst card then. There must be something good about it if it can eat out Boom Boss.
Well, I would say the...
I think the reason why he played it like... Captain's Parrot would be worse. Yeah.
Novice Engineer?
Yeah, worse. They draw no cards, just a 1-1. Yeah. The reason why he's playing Dr. Boom here is not so much, I think, for the value of the Boom Bots, as much as it is for just having the board pressure.
Oh, wow.
Oh,
wow! Wow!
And Life Coach with the disbelieving smile on his face. Okay, like, I could not account for that, even if I tried.
Like, let's be honest here. The game looked grim for Life Coach.
Now it's dead.
Now it's kinda
like it looked pretty awful, right? Going into the matchup, we didn't have high hopes.
Yeah.
And then it followed through. We had really bad start.
The Ancient Watcher happened. The
Ancient Watcher happened. Today. Boom Bots.
Yeah, that happened.
Yeah, so. I mean, esports, right? Esports.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh wow. No Shark Cleric.
Oh wow, like so disappointed. Free. Oh god.
Alright, so let's just give him one to take it away. And thank you, says Kolento here.
Lacker's like, yeah.
Good boom bots.
Nah, yeah, that's passiert. Manchmal that's passiert.
Oh man. I don't speak a word of German, but I'm sure the chat understood some of that.
I guess you like know few words, but those are banned in Germany.
Okay. Well, Life Coach just concede and is going to save himself and Kolento some time. Equalizing 3-3 for Kolento here.
Last game.
The very last game of the entire KPL. This will come down to this. We know the last matchup. Mechmage versus Grim Patient Warrior.
Yeah.
We've seen this earlier. It seems to be favored for the Grim Patient Warrior, but by how much of a margin, I couldn't tell you.
It depends. A few factors, of course, like, first of all, if there's an Emperor.
Yeah, in the hand.
And if there will be weapons for the first creatures. An example, if Kolento will not have Fear War Axe.
Right.
Or coin Death Spite, then he could just be stopped in his tracks.
Snowchugger.
Single Snowchugger.
Yeah.
One single Snowchugger would just be like, bam! You stand here, bro. You stand here.
Chugga. And you can't actually go through at all. There's no way you can get the damage in.
And then you have. You play like your Acolyte of Pain, and you have to use Taskmaster to trade for the Chugga.
Yeah, right? And then you lose the Acolyte. You draw cards, but you're still very far behind the temple.
I think there's almost no option that Life Coach will allow for that trade.
Yeah, it's a really problematic. And I think Grim Patron has only the executes to really do anything, to kill like a Snowchugger that's been damaged. They have no Shield Slams. That's the biggest drawback. Now, they do play Slams now, so they do have at least, you know, Slam Whirlwind.
Yeah.
But you know, we'll have to see how consistent it is. I still don't have enough experience because since Green Patron came about, Zoo was everywhere.
Yep.
And I know against Zoo it's typically okay, but how is it against Mechmage, which is weaker than Zoo?
It's the same. My guess is no Fear War X, no Patron Win X.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a bad pun.
Patron Bite. Yeah. That's Patron. I think Patron relies heavily around Death Bite, and Warrior can take out Blast Mage, you know, Spider Tank, name it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's what carries it.
There's the Fear War X. But there's an Oratron.
And there is an Oratron for Life Coach, and he plays Pilot Sky Golems.
Yeah, he loves that card.
That's pretty cool. Can't say I've seen much of it in Mechmage recently. It seems to be more aggressive than slow.
I think I still have Piloted Sky Golems miniatures in my house, like from the World of Warcraft miniature game.
Okay.
That was like a board game.
Okay.
Collectible.
I don't remember. I don't even know.
Really
that.
Cool one. Really cool one. Mechanics of that were really cool because they reflected on like a time mechanic. Like you actually spend time for casting
like
spells.
Like in-game time. Yeah. Okay, I get that. That's pretty nice.
Mechanics were really innovative. Like I liked it a lot. The figurines were kind of crappy when it comes to quality. But
yeah, welcome to cheap games. Now, Life Coach is going to throw everything but the Oratron, right? Like, there's no reason to keep Chimera Entity and Pilot Sky Golem. You want Mad Scientist and probably Mech Warper.
I guess the Kolento start is really great.
Yeah, Kolento start here again. I mean, I was talking about that with someone earlier. He is drawing super well in this league, in the playoffs so far.
And he throwed out the Oratron.
I'm actually surprised against a Warrior, that is your best bet.
Yeah.
Although it does play into Armorsmith and probably Acolyte of Pain, so maybe that's not what he wants to do.
No, but still against the weapons, that's like your best bet anyway. So now you have to drop Mech Warper into Clockwork Gnome, right?
So you're losing the Mech Warper, you have no card draw against the Fiery War Axe. I mean, what's the choice?
You have to do it.
Just try to get damage in as fast as you can.
If you don't play anything, you don't get damage in.
Yeah, this is just going to be problematic.
And at least you will get... Well,
the fact that
the Taskmaster will just seal the deal.
There was a chance. Although, if the Spider Tank comes out, Kolento then doesn't have an answer to it. Like, if Spider Tank follows up and then there's a good cure from Life Coach and Kolento whiffs a bit, I think Life Coach could still get it, but it's going to be really problematic.
When you think about this, like, Life Coach just will lose two cards to half of a card, right?
Yeah.
Each time.
Yeah, pretty much.
How can he...
He just plays the Clockwork. Doesn't want to overextend into the Axe. So he's going to try to probe for the Cruel Task.
I don't like this, to be honest. Like, what's the 10-3? You play Spider Tank naked, right?
And you lose it to
And you lose it to Taskmaster and Warwick. So it's kind of worse than playing Mech Warper and Clockwork Gnome.
Unless Kolento trades the War Axe away, but I would
I
be surprised
think
against
so.
Mech.
There,
yeah,
there's
against
no
Mech.
Way. You build the board with actually, maybe he will play the Armorsmith
and trades.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We know that better is the Taskmaster, but on paper it might seem that the Armorsmith would be better. I'm not sure. It's late.
The armor is actually not too bad to stack. It's just that you have very limited armor generation at this point.
Yeah, I think the Taskmaster is way better.
Yeah, against Mechmage you want to have a board. You want to be able to kill off the Oratrons with something.
Yeah,
and without that, you're not going to go anywhere.
So now you lose the Spider Tank.
It's fine. Oh,
wow.
Goodness. Well, that's, I think I'm just putting that down right here.
Yeah, you do. It's like such a big threat. I guess that's like the only option.
I don't see why you wouldn't play it. Like, you're getting a 5-4, you're forcing a Frostbolt ping, which lets you play Armorsmith or Acolyte of Pain on the follow-up. If things go wrong, like Frostbolt ping is the worst case scenario.
Yeah, 3 mana 5/4 seems like a good card.
Yeah, and now I guess Lifecoach is forced in a weird spot where emergency coolant is the only.
Only out.
Yeah, the only so real answer, but you're so weak to Death's Bite, you're so weak to another weapon.
And you don't want to play Mirror Entity.
Alright, he's just gonna play two minions and hope that he can actually finish the job off with a ping. He would be right, but not this time. Darklight Opinion will probably see the day.
That is such a bad situation for Lifecoach. Like, nothing works his way.
The card draw, the lack of card draw is really punishing him.
Yeah.
You can tell from the way this Mech Mage game is going, the card draw is a really big issue.
So now he has to kill the Acolyte of Pain. You just have to ignore the Frothing Berserker for a while. You drop the Mad Scientist and the Tinkertown Technician.
And you trade with the Acolyte. And
you trade with the Acolyte. Yeah.
You hope for the best for your followers.
You have to build the board.
And hope you can get it to stick somehow.
Yeah, something just to stick around. To deal the damage, to pile it up.
Yeah. Pile on!
We know it will be hard. There's like an execute.
Yeah, there's so many good, like, he hasn't even drawn with Acolyte yet. This is just the beginning.
Oh yeah, right.
He still has the Acolyte, he's got the Emperor as a backup. Any weapon that comes out will ruin Lifecoach's plan. Every step of the way, Lifecoach will have it difficult here.
True.
That's a really rough last game to get into. Mech Mage seems to be a really weak spot we saw a show struggle with it. And now Lifecoach seems to be in the same boat.
Stealth, that's not bad.
That's actually not bad at all. Could Archmage carry this, or is it going to be too late? Uh-oh.
Whirlwind, does it change anything? Not yet. Deathbite, well that's quite a problem.
Yeah, that is quite a problem, to say the least. Deathbite, execute, no, you can't.
Why
Deathbite, Dread Courser, execute is so disgusting.
Yeah, execute.
Disgusting.
You cleared the board.
Oh, goodness.
And?
Oh, Kolento! With the weapons.
That's such a huge tempo play.
And now Lifecoach is like, oh, I had to leave that Frothing alive.
Frostbolt? Nope.
Yeah, not the Frostbolt he was looking for. He's got the coolant, but that's not enough.
So coolant, the Frothing Berserker.
And then ping it to force the...
Ping the... I would say the pirates, because
I would ping the Frothing and attack into the pirate, the Mad Scientist, and then let him try the Deathbite. Deathbite's gonna fail miserably either way. I mean, otherwise, don't you just?
Nah, I think you have to ping the pirate. You ping the pirate.
Yeah, but when do you kill the Frothing? I would ping Frothing, then attack Pirate with Mad Scientist, then coolant the Frothing, and finish next turn to make sure you don't die right away. As bad as it is, you can at least play Mirror Entity on the back of that. If you're playing more than just Mirror Entity. And he obviously doesn't.
Armorsmith will calm down.
Yeah, probably.
Second Deathbite. Not really useful right now.
I mean, you almost don't want to proc the...
The first Deathbite?
Yeah, because the end of your Frothing dies. Maybe you just play Emperor. Let him trade.
But there's Mirror Entity.
Yeah, it's such a pain because you have to play around Mirror Entity. So Armorsmith, attack the Yeti, and then trade into... Frothing's gonna do nothing, almost. There's still a chance that Lifecoach gets this. If he gets, like, Dr. Boom on curve next turn, this could be the card that turns it around. Like, a good Dr. Boom here with the possible Archmage backend, on the back end.
I don't feel like attacking into the Armorsmith does achieve anything.
Well, what it does is that your Deathbite won't kill your 3-1.
Well, your Dr. Boom draw will not achieve anything because you have to ping the
Frothing, so you don't die.
Because that's like 19 damage.
So what does he need, actually? There's got to be one thing that helps.
Oh!
And the now unremovable...
That's like an immovable object.
The unstoppable force.
Yeah, that was actually items from World of Warcraft too.
Yeah, I remember back in Altaric Valley, you could fight. Yeah. You had like a shield. It was
hammer
called
and a shield, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was the name. And.
And there's nothing you can do about that floating berserker now.
I mean, you can ping it to help, but.
Oh yeah, sure, that helps.
If you could reversing switch it, that would be great. But.
Yeah, but you lack the reversing switch.
Now Kolento. He's like, this deck is ridiculous.
He draws all the weapons.
All of them, yeah. He needed weapons to do really well against mech. And this is exactly what he wanted. Those give him the early game that he wants. It allows him to remove the minions that the mech mage is trying to set down for tempo purposes. And now, the possible only way the life coach wins is if Archmage comes down with finicky Cloakfield.
Yeah, that's true.
That's the only thing I can see here for him.
Nope. That's going to happen.
That's not it. Snow trigger stealth. No, you can't afford stealthing this.
Clint is dying from laughter.
I wonder why.
Like, because of the frothing, like 119? Who saw that coming? I definitely didn't.
It's like the super gold shard footman. It's like a super warbot. Warbot guy.
With enrage single
yeah,
time.
Exactly. It's like
every single time.
Yeah.
From each creature.
Of course.
Super enrage.
Super rage.
Super troll. Trolling is a art.
Yeah. Trolling is an art.
A art.
A art, of course. It's like a trollception right there.
So you ping the face and you do nothing?
That sounds like an amazing line of play.
Well, you have to draw the Antonidas, otherwise you won't win.
Yeah. But even if you do, I don't even know if you... I mean, it's the only out.
Yeah.
So you have to take it. Although, does he win next turn anyway? He's going to go for the Finicky Cloakfield and a Chugger. The little Chugger that could.
Whoop-a-tsoop.
I don't think it can, but... He's the last hope.
Oh, look.
Another amazing card for Kolento.
Yeah.
Oh, this is getting completely absurd.
So you mirror entity on that, then you play Emperor, and then you attack face.
And then you Whirlwind.
And then you Whirlwind, and you have 5
1,000
plus
armor.
5, so that's 10. That's lethal.
Probably.
Wait, 4 plus...
But the Corsair is taunt, don't forget.
Yeah, I'm counting the damage. That's 4 minions, 5 minions, 4, 6 minions, that's 12, so you have lethal. That's exactly 18.
With the taunt?
Never mind.
Yeah, that's what I was telling you. I'm like, you know,
sorry.
Out the taunt.
Yeah.
That's a big deal. Sorry that happened. Hello. They're both exchanging really polite words. Very well-mannered players. Well, that's gonna be it for the grand finals. Life Coach is gonna fall down with his mech mage, a weak spot in his lineup.
Yeah, definitely.
Lost to Warlock, lost to Priest, lost to Warrior. 3 decks back to back, just completely obliterating it. And we had the exact same situation arise
with Sho,
who had the exact same problem.
Mech mage was the weak deck.
I would have to say, in this current metagame, there's definitely an argument to be made that mech mage doesn't work. At the moment.
Yep, doesn't work at all.
So I don't know what... maybe tweaked a little bit would do better, or if it just has to be thrown out the window right now with the advent of Zoo.
You just play Shaman instead of that?
Yeah. Mech Shaman or Zoo. Pick one.
Well, he was playing Handlock. But that's it.
Yeah, that's
Kolento's
it for the KPL Season 1. It's the grand champion. It's going to be Kolento. I almost want to say it's a surprise, but at the same time, it's Kolento. Everybody knows how strong of a player he is. But Life Coach could have won as well, and I think...
Yeah, Life Coach could have won as well. So congrats to Kolento and to Life Coach. Kolento is the first champion of Kinguin Pro League Season 1.
Yeah.
So he will be the defending champion.
In season two.
In season two.
Reinvited.
Yeah, of course. And life coach, kind of unsatisfied, I bet.
I hope so. I mean, he has to understand the variance hit him, but he's definitely played a good game. And sometimes the draws don't work, and the decks you bring don't do as well as you hope.
So, Kolento, you will be getting this trophy, I think, by mail, in parts.
Yeah, in parts. It will send whole, but we can't guarantee its arrival state. But yes, you will be getting this trophy, and congratulations to Kolento for the league. Everybody, I hope you enjoyed the entire event, the 2-month-long event, more than that even. All the games that were played, a lot of amazing matches. Today's game, the start was a little fast with 4-0, 4-1. 4-1, but then it started slowing down, and we had a lot more in-depth
games. It escalated.
Yeah,
into the final match, the grand final, 4-3. So,
best
of seven. Maximum amount of matches, we saw them all.
Yep.
And, yeah.
Doesn't get better than this, so thanks for watching, guys. We hope you enjoyed the first season. We will be back with season two a few months from now. There will be an open qualifier, 5 open spots in each group for Kinguin Pro League season two. We'll keep you up to date on that. You can visit the website at any time. We'll probably make announcements on that.
Kinguin.net/Pro League. You can check all the deck list, all the matches that happened so far, and finish the whole league. And also, after this broadcast will end, we will have a rebroadcast of the matches from the playoffs from today.
Right.
So if you missed something from the early games, don't worry, you can watch it now.
Yeah, it'll be just rebroadcasted right away. So thanks for watching, guys, and until the next time, have a nice one.